Well, Jack, I speak for all of the fellows. We're just delighted to have you with us, and thank you for making the effort to come all the way down here to the woods on the eastern shore to this modest little residence that we have here.
Reminds me of my own.
That's right. Good.
Sort of.
Let's begin with a very easy question, and one that's on everybody's mind in this room, though they wouldn't admit it. What's going to happen to the equity and the fixed income market in 2015? Should we buy or sell? Just hold on to our existing investments, and if we do that, and then cancel our subscription to the Wall Street Journal?
Well, if I may, first let me thank Phil for the introduction, my lovely introduction, and thank Judy for being such a great arranger of getting me down here. It's wonderful to be here. And I should say, with all due deference, Phil, the book sales in the last 2 weeks have been 3 weeks, I get 4 weeks now, have been slightly, only slightly, I'm sure Aspen is responsible for most of it, only slightly by the fact that Warren Buffett recommended it in his annual report this year. So you probably are the laboring war, Phil, but I don't know. It's kind of amazing. This is a book that just celebrated its 8th anniversary. It's been on number one on the Amazon mutual fund list. That's not exactly 50 Shades of Grey, but it's been on there, and still is on there now. And so it's pretty exciting to have it go on like that, and then get a nice boost from Warren. And it's kind of amazing to me. I did the best I could with it. I don't usually write the popular kind of. That's my most. I mean, I try to write it in the most basic, simple way, and it's not so easy for me. I'm not the best writer in the world, but it's great to see it do well, and has like 300 comments on Amazon or something like that. Pretty good. It makes me very happy. So that's good background. And now I'd like to answer to your question.
Great.
A little belatedly. Number one, we're obviously living in a world where there's a crisis around every corner. I don't think there's a much riskier time, actually, in a long, long time. In our world around us, I mean, you know, I won't enumerate the things because you're probably more familiar with these events around the world and in the country than I am. So it's very risky out there, and the stock and bond market are saying there are no risks out there. The bond market, presumably because of the Fed, not presumably, but certainly because of the Fed holding rates down, and the stock market influenced by that, because people have to choose between stocks and bonds, and if bonds get less attractive, and this is part of the Fed's great design, they think it's their responsibility to raise the price of the stock, of asset prices. So we'll all spend more if we're lucky enough to have assets. So it's a risky time, not reflected in the market. I should be quite blunt and say, I have never, I repeat, never recommended what the market will do in a given year, because I have no idea, and I don't know anybody that can do market timing that way, and I don't even know anybody who knows anybody who's been able to be successful in market timing. So that's just not my game. My game is to realize a very important thing about the stock market. I'll come to the bond market in a second. And that is, in the long run, the stock market is all about the returns earned by American business. And I have a little formula that I use, put together myself, not very much copied, but highly accurate, where you take the returns earned by American business are reflected in A, the current dividend yield, and B, the earnings growth that follows. And there's speculative return, two, I should say, there's speculative return, which is, are people going to pay a lot more for stocks or a lot less? If the stock price earnings multiple, the price people pay for a dollar of earnings goes from 10 to 20, well, that's a 50% increase, and that's 7% a year over a decade. And that's why times were so good in the 80s and so good in the 90s, and so poor in the 2000s. It's all the math of the market. So you can't guess anything in the short run. So I do my work on looking at in decade-long lengths. And I've been doing it since the early 1990s. It's been quite accurate. Not timing has always been a little bit off, but that's where the market returns come from. Fundamentals and not speculation. So where are we today? Today, the dividend yield is 2%. I think if we're lucky, we'll get 5% earnings growth in the next decade. That's a 7% investment return in the stock market. And we have to take in the price earnings multiple is high, relatively high, not super high, at 20. And it'll probably go down to something like 15, because when it gets to 20, it's more apt to go down than up over a decade. And that will, that kind of a change from 20 to 15, 25% decline, is about 3% a year off that 7% return on its crops. That's a 4% nominal return on stocks. And when you take inflation out, it's 2%. And here's the good news for all of you. We'll come back to this later. Take the expense ratio, the typical mutual fund out of that, which is 2%, and you were left with a nominal return of 0. Oh, you're all with me on the math. And let me just give you an example, if I may, from common sense. Written at the end of 2007, the book was published in 2008. I went through this exercise, and I had a chapter, and I have a chapter in the book called "What Happens When the Good Times No Longer Roll." And I said, you know, we're not going to get the same kind of returns we've had in the past because of the math. And I took them through the little chart I showed you, and I came out with a 7% return for the next decade. We're 7 years through that decade, and the return has been, he said with a little point of pride, 6.8%. So it's helpful. The timing is not always good, but I think it's quite clear we're not going to have the kind of markets we've had in the past. And most of the people whose opinions I respect are going to agree with me on that. In the bond market, it's the simplest thing in the world. Looking at it, the returns for the next decade on the bond portfolio is a 91% probability of reflecting the interest rate when you buy in, today's interest rate. So if you want to buy that 10-year treasury intermediate term bond at a little less than 2%, you're highly likely to get something between 1.5% and 2.5% over the next decade. There's no way around the math because it's an interest coupon that drives it. And so not very optimistic about future returns, but you got to tell the truth about it. So what do you do about it? First, never in the market or out, an unsatisfactory question. People that try and do that time the market totally, all cash today, all stocks tomorrow. Well, I don't mean to be crude, but should have their heads examined. Did I make my point clear? So it's really what your stock-bond ratio should be. I don't believe in commodities and gold because they have no internal rate of return, like I described for the interest rates on bonds and the earnings growth and dividend yields on stocks. So you're just betting that you can sell them for more than you buy them. That is what we call speculation. So if you're concerned, and there's good reason for concern, and you tend to be, I mean, I think most people should focus on more or less a 60-40, 60% stock, 40% bonds. Vanguard, we have a balanced fund that happens to have that profile, I guess because I picked it. You do want to lean a little bit to be 50-50. I would not take 60% equities up to 70. And I quickly add, I could be wrong. If I knew everything, I'd be 100-0 or 0-100. But I'd say lean to the conservative side and don't pay much attention to the bloody stock market. I have a sentence in my book, Little Book of Common Sense Investing, that says, the stock market is a giant distraction to the business of investing. Think about that. And that's what are we watching every day? Mm-hmm. And sooner or later, the returns regress to the returns of the business total, and those are the returns of the economy. It's not very complicated. I know that was long, but yeah. I didn't want to answer it in a flip way.
That was terrific, and there was a lot. I can see people were listening carefully. Let's maybe shift gear and talk a little bit about Vanguard, which is truly one of the great corporate stories of the last 50 years. One I think we all would like to, maybe from your perspective and looking back a little bit, you started Vanguard a little over 40 years ago. What was the state of the mutual fund industry? You, I believe, were in the industry, left, started Vanguard. What kind of drove that, and what was behind that decision?
Well, the industry that I came into in 1951, I got right out of Princeton University, went to work for Wellington Management Company, and in the middle of the go-go era, the mid to late 1960s, when lunatic stocks were highly valued, it was just an insane era, almost like the or the information age or high tech area or internet area that was supposed to come back at the end of 1999, beginning of 2000. And so when I came into the industry, I looked at an industry that was pretty good. There were about 75 stock funds, nothing beyond that. They all look pretty much the same. And they all look kind of a little bit like the Dow Jones Industrial Average. They all perform more or less the same, and because they weren't taking big risks, they were staying right down the middle, and they had a record that would lag the market. I did all the work in my Princeton thesis, which I wrote on this subject back in 1951, and it was a thesis that was very optimistic about this industry at a time when it was tiny, $2.5 trillion, and had the great hope it had for channeling the savings of Americans into the productivity of American business. Not a very complicated thesis. By the time 40 years ago comes, and I'll go back a little bit before that, this is 1966, the middle of that go-go era, Mr. Morgan, the founder of Wellington Fund, and the head of it, owner of it, although it was publicly held partly by then, came to me and he said, "Jack, I want you to take over the company and do whatever it takes to get it fixed. Because we were a very conservative company, and this was in an era of lunacy, and super growth funds, and our market share started to tumble greatly, and the business needed to be saved. And I did a really stupid merger. I said, you know, if you think American AOL and Time Warner was stupid, I beat them. If you know the kids' game, rock covers paper, I was the rock and merged with a firm that was paper, a little advisory firm in Boston that had a hot go-go fund and who wanted to run the well. I brought them in for their investment talent to run Wellington Fund, to get us into the pension fund, and give us that vaunted product for the marketing side of the business called iBest Fund. And it went swimmingly for about 6 or 7 years. The market collapsed. iVest Fund, the performance leader as it was going up, was probably the worst performing fund in the industry in that decline in 73, 74, and it went down 65%. And the other funds that my pals from Boston, these brilliant money managers, started, they're all going out of business now. They made no sense. I should have known better. I should have been fired. And I was. By the guys who ruined the performance of the funds, because they got more votes in this merger than I did. Is this a great country or what? And so part of this, so the industry had gone from a very good industry to a very bad industry, and it's actually a lot, we have elements of go-go, but mostly it's become a giant marketing business. Mm-hmm. And the marketing end of the business, always there, triumphed over the management end. And so you'll see, even we have, and I did this, I think, in a good way, but what do you do? Why do you have 270 mutual funds? Why do you have, in Fidelity's case, 370 mutual funds? What good does that do the investor in the long run? I think the answer is not very much, if any. You have to give them choices. For example, if you want a bond fund, we actually, one of our innovations was to say you have to decide how much risk you want, principal risk, and how much income you want. So you tell us whether you want our long-term bond fund or our short-term bond fund or intermediate-term bond fund. And that's the way the industry went in that direction. So today the industry is too much marketing and not enough management, too much salesmanship, not enough stewardship, and it's been taken over in a lot of ways by giant financial conglomerates who bought into this growing industry. And so we now have owners of these mutual fund management companies. And when they come in and buy a company for $1 billion, let's say, they're going to take 300 million or 150 million out of that business every year, 15%. That's their job. That's modern capitalism. Where does that come from? It comes from the pockets of the mutual fund shareholders. So costs, believe it or not, from an industry that went to $2.5 trillion, in 1951 to approximately $2.5 billion in 1951 to $15 trillion today the expenses are twice as high in ratio. I won't try the math on what it is in dollars, but I guess it must be like 200 times as many dollars coming into the industry. And has it improved management? Are you kidding me? It's just the same old thing. We're all competing with each other. We're all average before cost and below average after. So not a happy camper with the industry.
Well, when you started Vanguard, you moved over from this pleasant experience. Did you have a vision of the kind of company you wanted and what would be successful and what would be competitive coming out of that learning experience?
Well, I think a vision would be a little bit lofty for the way I think, honestly. I mean, I like the implied compliment. It actually, you could argue, it comes out of my Princeton thesis. I don't think it really did, but you could prove it, so I'll try and prove it by the words that were in that thesis. And I said things like, I mean, this is an idealistic college junior and then senior, and I can't shake the darned idealism even now, but even more idealistic. I'm more idealistic now than then, which I don't think is typical for most people. And so in my thesis, I said things like, the mutual fund industry's principal task is to serve the shareholder, not the manager. I said mutual funds should be operated in the most honest, efficient, and economical way possible. I had a sentence in my thesis that said, mutual funds can make no claim to superiority over the market averages. Kind of a hint about the index fund to come. And finally, that the industry should be focused on management over all its other duties rather than marketing. So it was predictive. I think that's idealism speaking and not some genius kid who knows who can build a company out of it. But it seems like in retrospect, that what I was saying there is what an industry has to do if it wants this. Everything I just said means we want to serve consumers. And Adam Smith wrote in 1776, words to the effect, is the principal role of the producer is to serve the consumer, a proposition that's so self-evident that I won't even try and defend it. And always good to quote Adam Smith. I did have the idea that we would be the low-cost provider. I did have the idea that if we were the low-cost provider, that the index fund could come into its own. And that low-cost provider coming out of a mutual company, I have never owned Vanguard. That's a unique structure in the industry. It's owned by the fund shareholders. That's where the economies come from. So if you've got the structure, your first question should be, what's the best strategy? Because strategy follows structure. And so it just followed very logically. I did have a group of Stanford students that I couldn't go lecture out there. I wanted to in the worst way because I'm kind of a lecture snob. But that Palo Alto was just too much for me, at least at the time. So they said, if you can't come to Palo Alto, we'll come to Philadelphia. So a whole bunch of them showed up in the office one morning, and they asked me a bunch of good, simple questions. But my favorite one was, I had a little slide presentation, and I said, our first business plan, no bullet points, a blank page. We never had a business plan. Our business plan was to get through the day. This company, $1.4 billion, down from $2.4 billion, or $2.2 billion, I guess, in the market and in the fund performance that had been so bad, everybody was liquidating. It was going nowhere backward. And so we had to kind of make it up as we went along. We're blessed, however, with a chief executive and founder who was a tyrant. And there was no question who was running the company. And it was a little bit capricious and arbitrary, to say the least. And I most of the things we did, I'm sorry to say, I mean, I'm embarrassed about this because it sounds so damned egotistical, but I decided. I didn't talk to anybody about it. I didn't see anybody around who had studied it more than I had. So we just did these things one step at a time. The index fund, the new form of bond funds. We had been sold by, distributed by broker-dealers all over the country. And after a big fight on the board of directors of the funds, we eliminated all sales commissions and an entire distribution force overnight. I had a busy time on the phone last day. So it's a product of, I think, some common sense, a lot of luck, but a timely thing, because most funds are created to make more money for the managers. You know, people bring out a hedge fund, they think they can make money, they really can't, they know that, but the managers always do very well. And in this industry, the managers who sold to these conglomerates that I mentioned, you know, do very well for themselves. That's the way you get rich in this business. Sell your company, but ours is not for sale because it doesn't really exist. It's owned by the funds themselves. So it's a little bit of a long answer, and I'd love to say I had this vision from the beginning and just executed it right out of my mind, but that would be false.
Well, you maybe answered the next question I was thinking of giving to you, but maybe you want to add to it a little bit. When you started out with zero assets in your fund, Fidelity, T. Rowe Price, others were really light years ahead of you. As we sit here today, and we've heard a couple of these statistics from Phil in the introduction, $3 trillion with a T under management, some 170 mutual funds, but we know that size is not everything in business, and we see examples of that every day. How I look at Morningstar rates you number one, that small company up in Boston, number six.
They're being generous. I shouldn't have said that. Mike, I'm sorry. Don't write this down.
I know. Is there anything else that you haven't touched on as you look back and reflect that really not only started that momentum but kept that momentum going all these years?
It's basically low cost. Indexing turned out to be an idea whose time had come, because in this costly industry, if you can be the low cost provider. Since we're all equal as managers, the active managers have to be equal. They're buying from each other. And I'll let you in a little secret. Every time someone buys General Motors,
somebody else is selling it.
Yeah.
So they're just trading with one another. Mm-hmm. And that's a way to enrich the brokers and enrich the managers with their management fees. So it's a very flawed industry in terms of the cost, the portfolio turnover, for example. The index fund we can run for about 5 basis points, 0.05, just a little drop in the bucket. And the typical active fund runs for about, you know, let me say, somewhere between 1% and 1.3%. So it's just a fraction of the cost. So the investor is given an extra 1% or so on that basis alone. Further, an index, you buy the Standard & Poor's weighted by its market capitalization, and it doesn't, meaning the largest stocks are the most important in the portfolio and in the index both, and so you don't buy and sell anything because the index is the index. And it goes up and your fund goes up and the market goes up or down, right in accordance with that. So we have probably 2% portfolio turnover on our index fund. That's expensive, not so much for us because we're not trying to guess at things or push the market. And the industry has about 140% turnover, portfolio turnover. That's a hidden cost everybody knows what it is, by the way, all these people that we compete with, I don't know what that cost is. Come on, if you don't know what that cost is, go get in the business which you know something about. So that's another like 0.75% cost advantage. And then we have no loads, as I told you, abandon the sales charge. So some of that's probably another 50 or 70 basis points on average of spread over time. So we have this huge cost advantage. And that's where everything else comes from. And you don't have to, when you're promoting, you don't have a hot fund to promote. You have a market. You're going to get we guarantee that you get your fair share of the market's return. Whether it is good or whether it is bad, I keep reminding people. And that's all we guarantee. And yes, people will move ahead of us, but they'll then move behind us. Everything reverts to the mean, becomes average and below because of cost. So it's a pretty simple concept. And the competitors hate it. When I brought out the index fund in 1976, it was underwritten, there was a big poster being passed around Wall Street. And it showed Uncle Sam with a great big, like a cancellation stamp, and with a field of stock certificates around him. And it said, and he's going, boom, boom, cancel, cancel the stock certificate. Stamp out index funds. Index funds are un-American. I have it out right outside my office. So, it was not popular. It took us a long time to get some momentum, maybe really into the late 80s or early 90s. It was a real fight. Everything we did was a fight, a battle over the competition, a battle to get our message across. And this may have occurred to some of you perceptive people in the audience. I love a fight.
I felt that there's something about Vanguard, and I'm sure people in this room have come to the same conclusion, that you haven't touched on that's contributed to the success, and is not easy, and it can only be achieved when it starts at the top. And what I'm talking about is, well, before I get to it, I will lead up by saying, you know, Vanguard seems to many of us to be the only shareholder cooperative out there dedicated to customer service. And I want to talk about customer service. And of course, into being the low-cost provider. But let's talk about customer service. In a sense, Vanguard is perceived by many people as us, the investors. But those of us who have, and probably speaks for everybody in this room, who have had careers and been in corporate business and know the importance of corporate getting a customer service culture, is extremely difficult to get going and extremely difficult to keep it going, recognize the importance of it. A lot of people give it lip service, but not a lot of people achieve it to the level they want to. And you've done it for 40 years. How'd you do it?
Well, you know, there's really quite an easy answer to that. I give a damn about people. I've often used the phrase, and let's never forget the honest to God, down to earth human beings. We're trying to find a way to achieve their financial goals. And I believe it in running a company. I spent much more time than any chief executive I've ever seen mingling, mixing, working with, rolling up my sleeves with the people who are doing all the hard work. And they know they have respect. They know they're going to see me in our little galley up there. We do not have, oh, this will surprise you, we do not have an executive dining room. I can't imagine anything worse for a company. Honestly, a company like ours, certainly I shouldn't criticize anybody else, but there was just never any question of doing that kind of thing. And so it's that you want, I mean, I'd get on the phones in the old days. I'm not smart enough to do it anymore, but and answer shareholder calls, and the people around me saw that. And I'm still very close to them. They know when I'm going to be in that galley every day that I'm there. With, I guess it holds 300 or 400 people. I don't know, that we're so far spread out that you can't do as much as you'd like. And they know I'm going to be there, and they know when I am there and when I'm not there. And one of our crew members, a lovely woman, just I guess 2 days ago, came up to me and she said she had a friend that didn't believe I ate in the galley, and which she could she take a picture of me eating there? And I said, well, that would be just fine. And then she said to her friends, she didn't do a selfie. I've had a lot of them. And I mean, it's amazing the amount of spirit the people we have in this big company. And now, and I think keeping those kind of values, when a company grows from 28 people, which we had at the start, to I guess we have about 16,000 crew members now, as we call them. I didn't like calling somebody an employee. I think it's demeaning and out of character, so we use a lot of nautical metaphors there. When my wife heard that the new exercise area at that goes off our galley was called the Shipshape Room, she said to me, don't you think you're going to run out of nautical metaphors? And I said, I don't think so. They keep going on. I mean, Vanguard, of course, was Nelson's flagship at the Great Battle of the Nile in 1798. And but $3 trillion means nothing to me. I'd rather complain about it than brag about it. And it wasn't so long ago, probably about a year and a half ago, when someone stood up in the Q&A that I was doing and said, you must be very proud to across the $2 trillion mark, growing quite rapidly. And I said to him, look, what do you think $2 trillion means to someone who has written a book called Enough? You know, I just was never in it for the size. I was in it for the fun, for the battle, for trying to keep people around me on the same level that I was. And I was an autocrat. I mean, please don't mistake that. I was worse than the Tsar, Genghis Khan, I don't know, you name them. We have a wonderful kernel of kind of personal respect and affection. I can guarantee that throughout the lower levels of Vanguard, a real identification with, and I talk a lot. I used to have speeches every anniversary, every $1 billion at the building. You know, it goes to 7 to 8 billion. Imagine that today. I'd be talking all day long if I was still running a company. But every time we'd have $1 billion cross, it goes from 7 to 8 billion, we'd have a party. I mean, that was a big deal. And at 10, we went to, I guess, 10, 25, 50, 100, 200, 300, 400. It's all like a whatever it is. So instead of being, not very many years ago, $200 billion behind Fidelity, now we are $1.2 trillion ahead of them in assets. That said, I hate to say this, because he owns his company and I don't own mine, Ned Johnson is worth more than I am. He happens to be worth $26 billion, he and his family, which is a living. Or at least I should say, I understand it's a living. I won't take it for granted. I wouldn't want that.
Jack, going from 28 employees to 16,000, you said, obviously you had to put in place over these 40 years and develop and grow a management structure, a team, and all. Not easy. Did you do it primarily from within, some from without, a combination? What was kind of the secrets of doing that? Because that's a real challenge.
Well, it's all from without, because when you there's only so much you can do from your from within when you've got 28 crew members.
Yeah, right.
So, and I was not particularly good about that. I don't consider myself much of a management person. I don't think I'm much of an executive. I talk about the value of teamwork often, mm-hmm. and I don't have a lot of that in me. Mm-hmm. Sorry to say. I mean, you probably can't sense all this. I mean, I don't know why I'm revealing the inner Bogle here. I just don't know how to kind of cover over stuff that's true. So we had some good people who were much better at organization than I would ever be. All the things that had to do with computers, and half of those 16,000 crew members we have now are in technology. In terms of investment, this is an interesting point. We probably have maybe, let me say 300 people out of that 16,000 working on investing and funds. Because indexing doesn't require that much. I mean, it requires a lot of, you know, when companies stock splits and all that, people have to do things, not very much in that case, but all that work has to be done. But it's not investing and saying, I think this stock is better than that stock. And when we had a vaguely managed mutual fund, they're called managed funds. I don't call them managed funds or municipal bond funds. There isn't a good municipal bond index. So I had to create municipal bond funds that were so index-like that they have a correlation with probably 100, perfect correlation with their share of the total municipal bond market. So it's a simple business from an investment standpoint. And the big test we really have, this is going to sound kind of bragging, I don't think it is really, but we have there are two sides to this business, any business. And this is really in response to your question, which is really so good. And there's the investment side. There's not much we can do wrong. We're going to give you the market return. Every once in a while, some funds will do better. Last year happened to be a particularly good year for the S&P 500. Just that sometimes it's particularly good and sometimes not particularly good because there are so many different kinds of funds out there. But that we have a lock on that. We will deliver on the promise. And if you pick an index fund that's in emerging markets, you will get that return. We have a few actively managed funds, some of which have done well and some of which have done okay. And so that part of the business is really under pretty good control. And the whole other side is the human side of business. And if you don't have people who are committed and dedicated and enjoy coming to work, you have a real problem. It counts how you feel about your job. And I feel profoundly about this. And I ask people, I spend an hour with each of our award for excellence. We have that kind of award program. I spend an hour with each one still. But I guess there are about 12 a quarter, something like that. And I never ask the question directly, but I can tell you they all say, there are two reasons these are not high-level people. two reasons they stay at Vanguard. We do have good benefit plans, competitive salaries, and then a partnership plan that I created where they share in the savings that we generate for our shareholders. And so they have a nice package, not hugely generous, but probably figure it out, 30% of their, usually at least when I was running it, 30% of the, you automatically in June got a bonus, an extra bonus topped out at 30% of your income. So you got great retirement plan, great benefits, competitive salaries, and then throw in the partnership. And so it's a good living. It's not sensational. But so we have that going for us. But the two reasons I get, sometimes 1-2, sometimes 2-1, I really like working for a company that has a sense of values, a company that has a sense of doing the right thing, a company that has something resembling integrity, a company dedicated to service, a company who knows who their clients are and we're dedicated to serving them, is one, call it the Vanguard environment. And the other is, very frequently and very strongly, maybe even stronger, I really love the people I work with. Now, you can't do any, I don't think, I wouldn't know how to do better than that. And if you can get that kind of a feeling, that kind of a commitment, and a lot of routine jobs that go on here. I did them partly because I was capable of doing them, unlike many of the non-routine jobs that are there. And it's just a pleasure to be around them all. As we get big, I have a saying, I'll give you business people in the audience a good sort of a tenet or motto. I have a speech I gave in 1995 talking about the perils of coming growth. You could see it all coming. It didn't take a genius. You used to take your growth rate and cut it in half and extend it for 20 years, and that's, you get to $3 trillion, or at least two. And so it was, for God's sake, I wrote one of these speeches to the crew. For God's sake, let's always keep a Vanguard, a place where judgment has at least a fighting chance to triumph over process. Well, I got bad news for you. The bigger you get, this is process, this is judgment. And you said it just right, exactly right. It's size is not my next blessing.
I'd like to shift a little bit, and something that's been in the papers for a long while, but certainly in the last couple of years, in the last 12 months in particular, and that's what seems to be the phrase activist investors, activist shareholders. I understand, and I've got a couple questions here, I'll roll together and let you attack them. I understand that Vanguard and some of its peers are considering joining the growing shareholder activist effort that is underway by shareholders to try to initially address corporate governance issues. And we've seen those issues kind of develop and change. I mean, 5, 6, 7 years ago, it was trying to get a lead director. It was trying to have more, and this was all really done through proxies. You've all probably recently been filling out your proxies in the last month or so for the annual meetings that are going on. It was issues like trying to vote out change of control provisions where existing management was helping themselves along those lines, more maybe overview of executive salaries. Now, of course, it's kind of, that's still going on, and they're looking for more disclosures about lobbying fees and all that kind of stuff. But now it's moved to where smaller investors, I mean institutional investors, hedge funds, is trying to come in and make changes in companies like they were a private equity company and they were going to buy the whole company and then they were going to do it for better or for worse. And we know there's a little
and bit leverage of, to the skies.
And leverage themselves to the skies. Now they're coming in and buying maybe 1 or 2% of the company, calling for the CEO to be fired. And they're all doing this from the outside, not from any inside information, and calling for, you ought to split this company in half and sell off this division and that division. And I don't understand the synergy and why you have those two different, complementary operations. It concerns me, and I worry, and I think back to my days when I was working for a living and all and was seeing some of our customers under pressure from the analyst community that they were really only interested in the next quarter earnings, which are often forecast by 3 or 4 26-year-olds. who've never had a real job in their life.
And actually, they're only 24.
They're only 24. You know, and they're not really interested in the long-term financial health of the company. They're just looking to pop it. I've kind of wandered on here, but it's a topic that's getting a lot of attention.
Well, you're certainly wandering along the right road.
Yeah.
You know, what's happened is we have a situation that has never prevailed in the history of corporate America. And that is, we've had, for as long as we've had public companies, an agency problem. Are the leaders of that company representing themselves or the shareholders? Executive compensation is a good example. Doing a merger to say you're bigger than the other guy is another example. Doing a merger so you can muddy the books and play with the accounting games is another example. And it's not a happy situation to have developed that way. But now, and that's an agency system that Burley and Means, if you're an academic, wrote about in 1935 or 1936, about the problems management. The book was called something like, I read it at Princeton, so I can't remember the exact title, in 1949, I guess. But it's the separation from management and ownership. And that's always a problem. Now we have another agency. We have the mutual fund industry owning 37%, the largest stockholder in America. And so the managers of the mutual funds are agents for the mutual funds, confronting the executives who are the agents for the shares, the corporation shareholders. And it doesn't seem to work very well. When you go beyond just the mutual fund industry, we're all, us and Vanguard, in a smaller way than most, but still there, partly in the pension business, defined benefit business, and certainly the defined contribution business, which were the most dominant industry by far. And so we have probably 55 or 60%. We control, this group of institutional investors, control 55% of all the stock in America. Vanguard alone controls 5% of all the stock in America.
Think of that.
BlackRock has, I think, the other 5%, and then you go down from there a little bit. So, but we don't vote actively. The SEC had proposals a few years ago saying, here are some ways you can get access, as it's called, to the proxy, nominate directors, vote on things. And nobody asked for more access, it was kind of limited, but nobody even wrote among our competitors. And this big issue with the SEC. None of the mutual fund companies wrote a thing. Of course, I guess it's not. I'll say it anyway. I was not running Vanguard at that time. So we have to take a more active role. But one of the problems is that we are running in our defined contribution plans and defined benefit plans, savings plans and the pension plans, we are running the money of the companies in our portfolio. Okay? So I could never find out who said this, but I recently came to the conclusion it was me. And that is, there are only two kinds of clients we don't want to offend in this business. Actual and potential. And that, correct me if I'm wrong here, but I think that's everybody. Because if you offend A, B is not going to give you his business. And everybody tells me that's overdone. And people have even told me it didn't exist, which I can't accept it doesn't exist, but maybe I'm overweighting it. And Todd, I think we should, actually some years ago, beginning of 2002, I tried to get together a bunch of mutual fund investors. I wasn't even running Vanguard there. Tried to get away together a bunch of mutual fund and pension investors to form a federation for long-term investors. People that would vote for their shareholders looking at the long term, not the recent earnings and all that stuff of the company. And we had a nice meeting in New York. Somebody else bought the lunch. And there were probably a dozen of us there and two or three people who wanted to be part of it but didn't dare be associated with it. That's how sensitive this issue is. And at the end of the meeting, the chairman of one of our competitors looked up at me and said, you know, Jack, I understand what you're trying to do here, but why don't we leave it to Adam Smith's invisible hand? And I said, for God's sake, Don't you know we're Adam Smith's invisible hand? So it's everybody's going to say it costs a lot of money. It does not relative to the size of this multi-trillion-dollar business. Everybody, and the idea was to get together and decide, look at companies as a group, and not tell anybody how to vote, but just to analyze it from the standpoint of the shareholder. And Benjamin Graham wrote at length about this, much tougher than I ever did, and ever even thought. But something has to be done to give the stockholders of American corporations, the stockholders of American corporations, now almost entirely institutions, in this what I called the double agency society, this agent facing that one. Someone's got to make sure those corporations are run for the benefit of their shareholders. I don't think we in this business, most of which aren't particularly well run, by the way, should tell corporations how to run themselves. I don't think we know how. So I think we should make a lot of noise about it. Just make sure the corporation is being run in the interest of shareholders, take it on political contributions, take it on executive compensation, take it on mergers, try and work on short-termism by saying you get a premium dividend if you've held the stock for more than 3 years, say, and be able to combine to vote if you've held the stock for 3 years and all of you together own more than, say, 5 to 10% of the company. And it's moving in that direction. It will. But it's going to be a long, tough struggle.
I have one more quick question, kind of another type of concern that I think the average investor, and then we'll throw it over to open the questions here, because I know there's a lot of them. I'd be interested in your thoughts if you think regarding the need for some types of new regulations or controls to protect what I would call the average investor. And I don't mean to protect them from making a wise investment decision or a poor one, but in this era that we live of electronic high-speed trading, the tremendous volatility that we have in the market, so much of it being caused by organizations that have enormous amount of assets, but they're buying stocks in the morning, they're closing out their books and all their positions at 4:30 in the afternoon. Their decisions are all based on mathematical algorithms. They really don't give a damn about how the company's doing or what's happening. It's all, is it up an eighth, down an eighth? Should we buy? Should we sell? I think this is turned off, and you know this, we read it all the time. It's disconcerting and unsettling to a lot of the average investors. And I'm sure, frankly, some of that might be why they're into your index funds. Does something have to be done to try to return and bring back what I would call the average investing market from which now, you know, many of people today, I think, feel that the market is just merely a provider of almost a technical trading platform. It has nothing to do with the typical investors. That's a mouthful for me, but...
Well, the first is a lot in what you say. I'm not happy with it either. But I guess the one thing I'd say is, it shouldn't bother anybody in the room, any stockholder, anyone that's investing for the long term, investing for retirement, and just trying to put his or her money to work satisfactorily, that these jumpy markets simply do not matter. I mean, they're funny. They do it for no reason at all. The press will give us an explanation of why they went up and why they went down without any knowledge. You know, they basically say it went up, it must have been some reason. No, there's no reason. Just a little speculative wave going through there. So it basically, I think the first responsibility we all have is not to really care about that. No mutual fund share, the shareholder is damaged by the fact that the stock market goes up and down. Like, and if you want to buy or sell during the day, I don't know why anybody would do that. I'll all come to another little variation on that in a second. It doesn't affect you unless you're actually part of the pricing. So the trick is, and we're starting to make a little progress, you may have read about it in the papers, we're trying to get this business to turn more toward being a fiduciary business than a marketing and a salesmanship business. And I actually have had the privilege of working with the people at the Department of Labor, the National Economic Council, and the Council of Economic Advisors to try and get this fiduciary duty standard applied to retirement plans by the Labor Department. And of course the SEC is complaining because it's their turf, But the Department of Labor is saying, well, wait a minute, if you're not going to do anything, well, we're trying to save retirement plan investors to get exactly where you are. And, you know, people should realize that activity is costly. The less active you are, the better you do. That's documented in our common sense. I shouldn't say documented, but you know it in your common sense, but it's documented in the data. And so it doesn't bother me much. We cannot turn our back on speed, even if we would like to, whether it's speed of the information age, speed in the stock market. I wrote an op-ed about this subject for the Journal of Portfolio Management Company, and I began with the first kind of speedy trading and maybe even inside information when Baron Rothschild heard about Duke of Wellington's victory at the Battle of Waterloo and sent carrier pigeons to London to tell his people to buy that the British Empire was in danger, imperiled, and all of a sudden they win this great battle of Waterloo under the Duke of Wellington, name of my previous company, and that's the first indication of speed coming into the market. And it's hard for me to see it can go a lot further, but it's now, the activity in the market is absurd. But the interesting part of this, and the deeply disappointing part of this to me, is that indexing has become the new speculative wave through these exchange-traded funds. And they're traded all day long. The original slogan was, now you can trade the Standard & Poor's 500 index all day long in real time. What kind of an idiot want to do that? I mean, I just can't imagine it. So, every day, look at the Wall Street Journal. Sometimes you've got to do a little math, but not usually. The most actively traded stock on the New York Stock Exchange is the SPDR, the Standard & Poor's 500 exchange-traded fund. It trades around $20 billion a day. That's an annual turnover of, I think it comes out to about 2,700% per year. 2,700% turnover. Doesn't matter to me. And actually, the inventor of that fund, if I can tell a little anecdote here, I don't want to waste all your time, but he came to me, Nathan Most, and he said, I've got a great deal for you. Came to my office down in Valley Forge when I was running Vanguard. And he said, I have a way that you can trade your S&P 500, and we use it. You can get much bigger because you can get all the traders. And I said, look, that's just not my bag. We're not going to do that. And it's now a hugely successful fund run by State Street. Ask me if I care. I mean, I just am not a trader. It's long-term investing. Mm-hmm. It's fiduciary duty with what we're working on in Washington. And people are figuring out a way that, you know, brokers aren't, where they don't have to say, I'm putting your interests first. Why anyone in the financial business who touches other people's money wouldn't want to say their interest comes first, I don't know. But we're moving towards something I've been in favor of for, maybe this is a good way to end the question, something I've been working for, you could say, since 1951. And that is to have funds run in the interest of their long-term shareholders and have a fiduciary duty to those shareholders as a federal standard. And we're creeping up on it through the Labor Department right now. So, you know, I won't see it come to its full fruition, but I'm very happy with the direction we're going, and I'm really happy to be part of it.
Good. Well, why don't we stop there, Jack? That's terrific, and we'll start with questions. Judy's over on this side, so we'll... Yeah, Judy's got the microphone. Why don't we start right here, and I'll just reiterate Phil's comment. I can see there are many questions. We have maybe, 25 minutes or so. So no essays. You get two questions in as long as they're not separated by an essay.
Two questions. You're welcome to comment on either one or both. One, given the cap weighting of the 500 index, tell us something about smart beta funds. And number two, your opinion of the Consumer Financial Protection Agency.
Okay. Number one, cap weighted versus smart beta.
You might have to explain that. Make sure everybody knows what we're talking
about. Smart beta is the new buzzword in the mutual fund industry. Smart beta is, if you will, well, let me say, I don't like new products. I don't like hot products. I don't like products. Mutual funds shouldn't be considered products. I don't like new products. New, and I don't like hot. So you can imagine what I think about hot new products. It makes no logical sense. It makes no mathematical sense. And there's no such thing as smart beta. If there is, there's got to be a dumb beta, right? Because we're all average in the long run. And you'll have to tell me that you can pick out the smart beta and the dumb beta. It just makes no sense at all. And I will rely not on my own feeling about it, which I just hate these buzzwords in this. This is a simple business. Why mess it up? But William Sharp, Nobel laureate in economics, and one of the great thinkers of American investing, worldwide investing for that matter, says, and I'm quoting directly here, smart beta makes me sick. I would never say that myself, of course.
Good.
And the second one was?
Oh, the second one, would you say something about the Consumer Financial Protection Agency?
The organization, the government?
Yeah.
Yeah. Consumer Financial came on after huge disputes in Congress, and I think was appointed when the Congress was out of session. They're still fighting about that. I do not believe in big government, but I believe that the financial industry generally, consumers, credit, mutual funds even, has unfortunately earned government oversight. You know, if there's no problem there, the government doesn't need to do anything. But there is a problem there. And there's a disclosure problem, an information problem, an overcharging of interest rates on the consumer side mainly. And the mutual fund industry has its own set of problems, just marketing these new funds and overcharging and all that. So I don't like it, but we need it, so we have to have it.
Good. Any other questions on this side, or we'll come back? We have one right over here. Shudi?
Thank you very much for coming out this evening, bringing so many years of successful experience. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Your prediction on inflation, where are we going to go with inflation?
That's a great question.
And I've got another one, please.
Okay. No, that's all right. First, we're going to stay, I believe, at low inflation levels for longer than the Federal Reserve keeps this very tight money policy. And I think that's because we don't have a great big underlying consumer demand in this country. Consumers are still somewhat extended. Corporations are not particularly extended in trying to deleverage, as they say. So money is going to have to go to deleveraging across the board. But when you're talking about these kinds of things, the consumer is obviously what you're asking about. And so I think that we ought to be able to stay in this range of, say, 1 to 2% for a fair amount of time. I don't know any better than Janet Yellen does whether that's going to be a long time or a short time. But at the end, you know, we'd probably be walking along with a more traditional, like, 3% inflation. I don't see it getting out of hand and out of control. The inflation bond, we have as many of you probably know, you can buy a 10-year Treasury note or bond, short-term bond, 10 years, and it will yield you about 2% today. But you can also buy one that has an inflation hedge in it. So if inflation goes to 4%, you'd get more money than the fellow that doesn't have that protection. It's about 2%, and the inflation bond is selling at about zero, maybe even negative. So the market is saying, and the market is not always stupid, the market is saying, be pretty relaxed for as much as 10 years. I wouldn't be relaxed about anything out there for 10 years. The world has too many uncertainties in it. But I don't see a big wave of inflation like we had after, for example, World War II.
Second, with an $18 trillion deficit, and it's increasing approximately $1 trillion each year, how are we going to handle this, and can we handle it?
Well, I usually talk about Social Security deficit, that's an easy one to solve, Social Security. But the only way you can do it at the federal level is raise expenditures or reduce revenues. I mean, these deficit problems are very easy to conceptualize. Will we grow out of it over time as we get some better economic growth? That could help. Can there be things done to cut back in government? Well, the answer is it's Herculean to cut back government. I can't give you the exact number. But if you take things the government cannot cut back on or will not, I won't argue the good or bad on this, like military, like Social Security commitments, like paying the interest on the federal debt, which is quite large enough, thank you, and that will probably go up as interest rates will go up. It will go up. The federal debt is not particularly long in its holdings out there. So you're working with a very difficult, a very small portion of the total budget when you try and cut there. You can raise taxes, of course, and I think I'm kind of in the group that I guess I'm deep down sort of between a communist, a socialist, and a Marxist. But I believe that we have an obligation in this country to take the best care we can of those who aren't as privileged as all of us in this room tonight. And I don't mind paying my share of that. Unfortunately, the amount of waste there is enormous. When you get federal programs that apply to hundreds of millions of people, you know, it's going to have some waste in it. I'm sure that could be approved on, but that's not going to solve the problem. And I don't think you can really raise taxes a lot because the top 10% of the taxpayers are probably paying, let me just guess, it's 75% of the total tax burden. But it's a totally disproportionate. And I think someone else would be better at this than I am, but around 40 or 50% of the quote taxpayers in the country pay no tax at all. And they're down to very low earnings level. They're paying Social Security taxes, which at 6 or 7% is a big, big hunk of their compensation. You know, $20,000 a year or whatever it is. It's pretty low. So I think the best possible approach is to try and do things that are more efficient in the way we tax. I mean, I think it's ridiculous. Well, I feel anyway. I'm going to say it. That'll surprise you. It's ridiculous that hedge fund managers can take their earned income and pay a capital gain. Oh, all right. I thought I'd be with people disagree with me. I think it's ridiculous that we let mortgage rates be unlimited. You know, the whole idea is to make sure that people are able to afford houses. But if you get to, let me just pick a number out of the air, $200,000, you know, that would be the limit on any mortgage I would allow. And those people maybe need the help a little more. There's no way to get equity. And as anybody will tell you correctly, that if you have capitalism, you have inequity. There's no way around that. Whether it should be this extreme, I am deeply concerned about the inequity in our society, the spread between the top 1% and the bottom probably 50%. And I actually have a file, Mike knows about this in the office, where data on this inequity and articles and things like that come up. And the file is entitled America. I just don't think it's right. I wish I could solve it. But I think it's not at all hopeless, particularly if we don't grow, we have a real problem on our hands. But the growth will help. Some intelligent elimination of tax advantages will help. And maybe some tax increases, different kinds of tax increases. People talk about a value-added tax. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're all still taxes, but it's a very problematic, to say the least, problem. And I wish I could have enlightened you as to how to fix it. But Mike is going to do that tomorrow. Yes, sir.
One in the back. This was quite enlightening. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
I had the good fortune and the quite stimulating experience to work with or to study from William Sharp at Stanford. Great guy. My question to you is the following. This 2% return that someone might realize on a Vanguard investment, the 0% real return if you go with Fidelity or T. Rowe Price, is it possible to know something about these markets with hindsight to determine whether investing in specific developing economies, given their macroeconomic profiles, in specific sectors, in particular risky categories of equity based on their correlation with market ups and downs and the little bit that's left over when you take those correlations out? Is it possible to make better decisions about where you put your money? And I'm sure Vanguard has products that that address these issues. Can you give us any suggestions about where a good place to be if you're 70-something and contemplating maybe two or three more years of productive life? You might want to put your money.
My first thought is, oh, to be 70 again. I think that the risk of investing, let's say the risk of owning the stock market, is quite large enough. The stock market is the stock market, it does what it will. Trying to go beyond that risk by taking greater risk, somebody else can be taking lesser risk, obviously, because it's all a closed circle. I think it's very unwise to take an extra market risk to buy individual stocks, to buy individual groups of stocks, to buy sectors, which are traded a lot in these exchange-traded funds. I don't think the traders do very well. So there's some problems that trying to get around them is going to be more expensive than trying to stay with them, no matter how limited the returns are. So I would not do it. Now, you talk about, there's a lot of talk about, and I get in a lot of trouble in this when I speak out of it, but I'm saying the same thing for, like I have with everything, for about 35 years, maybe 50, maybe 64. You have to realize that it's a zero-sum game for all of us together. So if you're, as I said about the beta thing, if you're the smart beta, there's got to be a dumb beta there. But I do get in a little trouble about what you specifically asked about, and that is non-U.S. stocks. And I just don't believe that countries out of the U.S., I think is a great country to invest in. We have the best technology. We have the best national growth, not compared to China and India and so on, but of the established companies. We're doing much better than European countries about the size of the U.S. together after the recent unpleasantness back there in 2008, the financial crisis. But if you're these U.S. corporations receive half of their revenues and gain half of their earnings outside the U.S. So you're betting that the foreign markets will display that differently. We also, by the way, very importantly, as long as you don't have it, when you don't have it, you'll know what you missed. But we also have the most established shareholder protections in the world. You can be confident that the institutions we have built up in this country are giving the owners of stocks, the owners of anything for that matter, greater protection than probably anybody in the world. Maybe not England, but right up there. And so I just don't see the value in doing it. I know I am not smart enough to do it, but if you think you know more than the market, be my guest. I don't like the extra risk. I don't like the concentration. I'm willing to take America's business's return and the whatever returns the bond market are offering, and not even the good rule of investing. Never peak. Never peak. That's P-E-E-K.
Well, Jack, thank you very much. I think it's been a stimulating hour plus. We appreciate your comments. We appreciate the effort you did to come down here and share your wisdom. You can see you had a rapt audience. I don't know if they're going home feeling better about their portfolio or not.
Well, I can only say the facts.
I think you're, once the Buffett factor is over with your books, I think the Aspen factor will move in here with the Y fellows. Like hotcakes, and we just very much appreciate what you've done for us.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.